very warm welcome to everybody. I am Shrija Agrawal and you are watching yet another episode of Mint Insight. With me are two very special guests today to really talk about what really is at the heart of all newsroom conversations these days. India-US trade relationship or trade relationships at large. Any conversation about trade or economics is not really complete without referring to the famous Thomas Friedman's book, The World is Flat. But surely the question now becomes that in this wired world, the so-called wired world of where this free flow of ideas, money, capital, is that really happening? Is the world really flat? Increasingly, there seems to be that we are living in the world of silos where more and more local conversations are happening. With me, our extremely distinguished guest, Rohinton Medhora, who is the president of CIGI, and Akshay Mathur, who leads the head of research and the CEO for Gateway House, to talk really about these issues. Rohinton, my first question to you really is about where does India really stand in this entire global quagmire of trade wars, so to speak?
So first, thank you for having me. It's sure. Good to be at the Mint offices. The U.S.-China disruption is a structural long-term one that's been brewing for some time. This is not about Trump. This is not about one or two people not getting along. It's about the fact that over a decade ago, when we as in the WTO community, allowed China to become a member, China played by those rules and then some, and did so extremely well, and has now become both a technological, military, and economic power. At some point, this is being seen, especially in technology, as a zero-sum game, in which if China wins, someone else loses. That someone happens to be the US. Now, in all of that, you ask yourself, well, if this is the way it is, does it mean that other countries would benefit, or would they find themselves in the same kind of issue?
Sure.
So my sense is, number one, if any country became as powerful as China, it too would face the wrath of protectionism in Europe, in the US. Second, we would be deluding ourselves if we think that any country can displace China. China's just so ahead in terms of size and manufacturing and technological prowess that I cannot think of very many countries that could do it. But third, what we see in the data is that as protectionism against China has increased, manufacturing operations have moved to Vietnam, they've moved to Cambodia, sometimes Burma. So it's more Indochina and Southeast Asia that's going to gain. Now, that isn't to say India could not gain a bigger foothold in all of this, but to see this purely in terms of gaining at the expense of China would be missing the bigger picture.
That's interesting. I think you made a very pertinent point about, you know, gaining at the expense of China, missing the big picture. So really, Akshay, what really is the big picture that you can throw light upon?
If you see when the US and China trade war started, a lot of analysis was done to understand what kind of firms in China are being affected. And it turns out that a lot of firms in China were actually American firms. And a survey that was done of the American firms clearly said that they were looking at Southeast Asia as the number one region to shift their manufacturing base to. That's exactly what Rohinton just said. But the second priority was India. And since then, over the last 2 years, we have seen Indian exports go up by 6 to 8%. So there has been some benefit that we have taken. I do want to add, I think there is usually a misperception that India is not a trading power. You know, India's trade to GDP is around 43%, which is higher than the trade to GDP of China, which is at around 37%, or United States at 25%. So it's not true. India is a trading power, and we do want to trade. You've seen that Prime Minister Modi has given a benchmark $5 trillion economy by 2025, but a big portion of that is going to come from exports and trade. So we have benefited immediately from the after effects of the trade war, but we have, you know, we all know that there is a domestic competitiveness issue because of which we're not able to take full advantage of the situation just yet. One of the things that we would have to do to take advantage of what China might possibly lose out is that we would have to get more medium enterprises involved in trade. Some of the latest numbers show that it's only the large multinationals, especially those that do both import and export, are the ones that are benefiting, are involved in global value chains and global supply chains. So if it's only the large multinationals that will benefit, you will see that there's going to be a pushback from rest of the industry organizations in India. And that's what you saw in the RCEP negotiations.
Yeah.
The pushback came from the farmers, farmer unions, from the small and medium enterprises, from the trading organization. And that has to change.
So I think the key takeaway is that we really have to up our quotient as a trading power and trading prowess. And this entire, you know, mission statement of the Prime Minister that we have to be a 5 trillion economy by 2025. I want to understand that, you know, what opportunities do countries like Canada really offer in that conversation, in cementing our trade relationship further?
The Canada-India economic relationship is actually underexploited. So the upside is quite high. On the other hand, at the end of the day, Canada is a medium-sized economy. It is a G7 economy, but it still isn't going to pull India up. This is not where India will make its 5 trillion.
Yeah.
Where I think it would make a difference is in the quality of the relationship. And I know we'll get to this, but I'd say two or three things. One, the high tech sector, the green tech sector, these are things in which I think Canada and India can play and up their game. And the second is on the investment front, where Canada has very active pension plans that are looking to diversify. That too, I think, has huge potential. The third is for Canada and India to work jointly to recreate a rules-based multilateral system, because both countries have an interest in not allowing it to fray any further and, in fact, to build it up.
Interesting. I think you mentioned about, you know, the entire technological advantage that we can get with India and Canada, and also this point about Canadian pension funds investing in India. You know, we really have a lot of Canadian funds now coming and investing in India, and large significant amounts. One perception really is that it's just easy pension money coming in here. But the return expectations of some of these funds are really really comparable to any conventional private equity fund. So I really want to understand that we have seen this corridor, you know, being built out a few years back with Japan, for instance. Mm-hmm. We saw a lot of Japanese investments coming into India. Mm-hmm. Are we looking at a very deeper relationship with Canada on that front?
The Japanese analogy is a good one, but it's not perfect. As I understand it, the India-Japan corridor was one in which investment and trade were complementary to each other, and Japanese multinationals saw the investment corridor as a way to gaining a foothold both in manufacturing and in the Indian consumer sector.
Manufacturing, largely, yes.
In the case of Canada, that's not quite how I think it's going to play out. Our pension funds do not represent manufacturing interests. They are genuinely pension funds, and there's a push and a pull thing going on. First, Canadian pension funds, which have mostly invested in sort of developed markets and the U.S. and in Canada, are looking to diversify. And so if you look to diversify with that kind of portfolio, then India is the obvious place to go. Second, Canadian pension funds have a reputation, unlike U.S. pension funds, for example, of taking direct positions and not working through equity arms. And so in things like infrastructure investment, in which India, I think, could upgrade if it wishes to be competitive and reach the 5 trillion, you're not going to do it with your current infrastructure, then in fact it would be the case that Canadian pension funds have the know-how. On the Indian side, which is the pull side, long-term capital in India is drying up, has dried up. So if you're looking for high-quality, patient, long-term capital, then Canadian pension funds are an obvious answer. But it's not going to be in the manufacturing side. It's going to be much more in these high-end value chain and service industry.
Countries have a lifetime of their own. We talk about technology companies, you know, having a finite lifetime. I'm increasingly getting to believe that perhaps even countries have that, you know. And as India is getting towards its, you know, large, big center stage at the G22, you know, I want to understand that how can India own that conversation of being a superpower, especially in dialogues of trade, economic, supply chains?
I do think countries have their moments, and actually more than moments, they have their eras, and that these are cyclical. And so I happen to agree with your hypothesis. This could be India's time. Now, what you have to watch out for is the old joke about Brazil. You know, Brazil is the country of the future and always will be. But at some point, you have to realize that potential. Currently, the stars are aligning in a number of ways. I'd say, as we began the conversation, to say that if you're thinking of, other than China, which emerging country is one that can truly play a global role, it's India, in size, in scope, in its capacity to innovate, in all of that stuff. Demographics, hugely important. And here, India has a leg up on China. China's population is already aging. India's is not. And so there's very many models that show that India's growth rate will surpass China's in the next decade or two. Second, as India plays a global role, it will have to play a global role. What that means is, of course, every country plays a global role by seeing the world through its lens. But you have to give and you have to take. And how India plays its presidency of the G20, which is not a one-year thing, it's a three-year thing, because there's the troika system in the G20. That will be a huge coming-out moment for India on things like WTO reform. Setting the new rules of the game in our global data economy, which is balkanized between the China zone, the GDPR zone, and the US zone. Countries like India and Canada feel frozen out of that game. Can we create new rules around data? Can we create new rules around intellectual property and around green tech transfer? So there's a lot of next generation global governance issues on which India can play a role if it wanted to, and it would be in keeping with the point that India's time has come.
It's a very beautiful explanation from Rohinton on India's time can truly come and what the kind of areas India can truly focus upon. Any last comment on that and then we can wrap up?
Foreign policy and economic diplomacy cannot get ahead of the domestic economic strength. So ultimately everything will derive out of how powerful and how competitive we are internally. And also that we do play a role regionally, whether it's our naval presence, whether it is disaster relief or with our neighbors. And on G20 and WTO, we have switched, this is marked switched in the last 5 to 6 years, from just being obstructionist to at least having conversations and providing some new proposals to move the conversation forward. That's a huge change. I think a lot of people don't realize that, especially in India, that we do have a proposal at the WTO to move trade and services forward and things like that. So looking forward, we would have to provide proposals. And I think that's what the government is doing increasingly.
Interesting. So on that thought, that G20 can truly be India's moment to come, here's a wrap up from Mint Insight. Till the time we see you next, goodbye and good luck.